Can everybody hear me? Good. So like Jay said, we're going to talk about pesticide drift liability today a little bit. And hopefully this works. So I work in the Department of Ag and Resource Economics, but I also am a partner with the Ag Law Education Initiative. There's our website, social media. It's a collaboration between the University of Maryland, College Park, where I'm at, University of Maryland's Carey School of Law in Baltimore, and then UMES here on the Eastern Shore, and we're funded by the University of Maryland Empowering the State, and which is a collaboration between College Park and Baltimore. You can get more information at empowermaryland.com on that. I am an attorney. None of this is legal advice. I'm glad I have this on tape, so if anybody comes back later, we all know this is not legal advice. Other things we do that John kind of talked about as well when he was talking about crop insurance. With crop insurance and ag law, we kind of put information up at aglaw.umd.edu. If you like the sound of my voice, I sometimes read them. And now we'll get started. So to kind of get started, I've given this presentation a few times, so I kind of know the answer to my question by now, but I assume most of you are concerned about pesticide drift liability, correct, in some way? And I should point out my pictures never make sense to what I'm talking about. They're just to keep you awake. So the first speaker already hit upon this too at the dicamba issue, so I really don't need to go over this. Most people have heard about the dicamba issue. But if they haven't, I have my timeline wrong. I have since learned. I'll explain why I know my timeline is wrong in a minute. USDA approved basically new dicamba Roundup Ready to extend soybean and cotton in 2015 with cotton and 2016 with soybeans. Both are resistant to dicamba, but not resistant to dicamba on the market at the time when they were first initially sold. And in fact, Monsanto either warned growers not to spray it or potentially, according to something else later, actually did not tell them to do this. It's not entirely clear as to what happened. Many growers did not listen to this and sprayed it anyway with dicamba. We had drift issues all the way from Minnesota down through the South. And EPA approved the new dicamba. I think it's called Vapor Grip.
Extendamax.
Yeah. So what penalties did producers face? And this is where we kind of get in some of the drift liability issues. For many of them, it was not following the approved label. It clearly stated on the label they were not supposed to spray this on these crops, and they did it. Anyway, I have the Arkansas, Missouri, and Tennessee complaint numbers. I have not found the complaint numbers yet for the other states yet. So there were 271 complaints filed in Arkansas, Missouri, and Tennessee. Complaints typically range that farmers would face fines up to $1,000 for not following the label per violation. And it's unclear the percent of damages. I have yet to find a number on the amount of damage that was caused by this yet. In December, we had the largest peach grower in Missouri sue Monsanto for this issue, for pesticide drift, for their losses. And last month, actually 2 months ago, it's now March, three Missouri farmers filed a class action lawsuit for growers in 10 states currently unknown against Monsanto for this drift liability issue. Their claim is up until the dicamba came on the market, these two soybeans and cotton were defective products, and they were not good products until the dicamba came on the market. It is a very interesting legal theory, but... Oh yeah, and there's one more thing that arose out of this. Just one more. We had one shooting that led to a death out of all this. Now, I need to lay some facts out about this shooting that happened out of all this. This farmer had faced drift issues year after year after year. It was not just 1 year where he lost his crop. He faced this year after year from what I've read. And he went and did what anybody else would do. He confronted his neighbor about this. His neighbor pulled a gun and shot him. So now his neighbor's in jail. And so far, it's the only shooting we know that has arose out of this. So we don't want anybody to get shot over this stuff either. So where are we going to go with this? So when I look at Maryland law on this, we really don't have any pesticide drift cases reported. We have stuff reported through MDA. I didn't look at those mainly because I focused more on how does this play out when it goes to court. When we look at the reported cases, there's really no uniformity. For the most part, many of them follow this idea of negligence that we're going to talk about here in a minute and variations of negligence. A few have looked at it as trespass, and a few have looked at it, for the most part, as violating the statute or the regulation, i.e. not following the label as you're told to do. The lack of uniformity causes problems. It's very hard to kind of figure out how these things will play out and give ideas as to how that will happen. So to kind of lay the groundwork for this, negligence is just simply the failure to exercise a duty of care under the circumstances. We all expect people to act a certain way every day. You're walking down the street, you don't expect somebody to hit you. You kind of just expect to walk down the street and nothing happened to you. So when something happens that breaches a duty of care, that's when we have a negligence. Trespass, most people know what trespass is, but how many people know that some courts look at this and say dust and microscopic objects can create a trespass when you put it on somebody else's property? So some courts have actually gotten down and looked at pesticide drift as a trespass, you putting something on somebody else's property. And the idea is basically if you throw something on your neighbor's property, you may not have gone on their property, but you threw an object on their property. So that's follows through on trespass. You've now put something on their property without their consent. So for the most part, these things turn on drift as negligence. So to kind of lay out how you figure out a negligence claim, nobody knew this was going to be a law school class today. So with it, you have to show that you owed a duty of care to act reasonable under the circumstances. And this is just pretty much the idea of what do we expect normal people to do in circumstances. With drift, we don't expect sprays to come on too far on the neighbor's properties. Courts usually look at it and do say some drift does happen periodically. Then we have to show that you breached the duty of care and that there was the breach was the proximate cause of the injury. The idea of proximate cause is sometimes things are so unforeseen, they're outside this zone of danger that we would expect. And you're no longer on the hook. Even if we can show breach and that there was a duty of care, if you're outside the proximate cause zone, it's not. And to give an example of what proximate cause is, imagine you're in the 1930s and you're running down a train track to catch a train that's leaving. Someone from the train company helps you up on the train and another person with the train helps pull you up. You have a package under your arm, it falls under the train and explodes because you have fireworks under your arm. How many people expect that to happen every day? So bizarre. Now, make it even more bizarre. When the explosion happens, it causes a shockwave which knocks a scale off the top shelf and hits an old lady in the head. The only person out of all this we know her name is Mrs. Paulsgraf. The court looked at that and said this was so far outside the zone of danger we didn't expect it to happen. You don't expect an explosion to happen when you're helping someone on the train. So the train company was not liable for that damage at that point because it was so unforeseen to have happened. And with pesticide drift cases, for the most part, it's always going to be showing breach and proximate cause because you can almost always point to someone else and we can never clearly say it was you at some point. So let's look at the cases. I need to point out with almost all the cases but one I'll talk about, they're almost all aerial application cases. There's very few ground application cases that have led to pesticide drift claims in courts. Here we have Roundup Ultra being sprayed by a pilot, causes drift, farmer sues farmer of neighboring farm and pilot for this. And our court looked at it and said there's no clear evidence he was negligent. He was the only witness and took all the safety precautions. If you're the only witness, how likely are you to admit you screwed up? No one's ever going to admit they screw up, except in, we'll talk about one time when one person did here in a second. There were no witnesses to the drift. You'd be shocked how many times looking at these courts want to see a drift cloud and want witnesses to see the drift cloud take place. It was a very common pesticide being used. It was very hard to show the drift actually came from the neighbor. It could have come from another neighbor or someone else. And the application was made under safe conditions. The pilot went back, could show the weather records for what it was like that day and could show he did it under safe conditions with the proper equipment. What would change the outcome in the case? Didn't use safety precautions, possible witnesses, less common chemical, could all change this in some way. To kind of build upon this, there's this idea of negligence that sometimes things just happen and we can't prove negligence, but because they're so random and happening, the fact they happen creates a negligence case. And to show this, it's called rips ipsa loquitur, and I'm really glad I could say that early in the morning. But the idea is that the accident is such that it would not ordinarily occur outside of negligence. I have an example here in a second to kind of explain this. And the instrumentality causing the injury is completely under the control of the defendant. So the defendant had complete control of it. So let's take an example of a man walking down the street one day, passes an open window, and a flour barrel hits him on the head. How many people expect that to happen every day? And he'd point out, again, actually happened to a man. So flour barrel falls out the window, did not kill him, actually. He walked away. It was in the 1800s, so in England. But no one expects this to happen. The fact that flour barrel fell out of the window itself is enough to show negligence. We don't actually have to show any of the elements of negligence. Just the fact that flour barrel falls out of the window is enough to prove that the defendant has at fault. Two Texas cases that have looked at this. Texas is the only state that has found this to be in one case. There, the discharge just happened. There was no proof of anything as to why it happened. It just all of a sudden discharged out of the plane for no reason. It fell on the neighbor's property. There was nothing to show why it happened, why it didn't. So in this case, the court was pretty clear that it was rips ipsa loquitur and negligence applied. But they looked at another case and they basically said, no, it's not just as simple as showing the equipment. There was no way to show the equipment screwed up as in the last case. It just happened. Here there was no evidence anything negligent happened. Drift, according to the court, and most courts, always will happen in some cases. And again, we go back to the same elements as before with the Roundup Ultra stuff. There was only one witness, the pilot, who took all the precautions. They could go back and check his equipment to show it was working properly. There were no witnesses to show drift took place. It was a very common pesticide to take care of boll weevils. And the application was made under safe conditions, so they didn't allow it to apply there. The final idea with negligence is this idea of strict liability. And the idea is just you doing the thing itself is so dangerous. If you hurt anyone, you're negligent. I don't care how many safety precautions you take, you're negligent. My example here, for anyone that saw the movie The Hangover, because this is the best example, Mike Tyson owns a tiger. No matter how many safety precautions Mike Tyson takes, if that tiger gets out, he's liable for all the damage, regardless of if we can show negligence. Just the fact he owns something that's dangerous and it causing damage is enough to prove negligence. One state has taken the strict liability approach in the 1950s. My home state of Oklahoma, this is the only case involving ground application. Landowner used 2,4-D to kill weeds on his property. It drifted over, actually killed the neighbor's cotton. The court basically ruled in this case that the landowner used it at his own peril, and the fact that the drift happened, he was enough to show he was liable for damages. Need to point out, cotton is a 2,4-D sensitive crop. There are other 2,4-D sensitive crops. That could be one reason why this turned out this way. You know, what if it's another, you know, crop sensitive to either dicamba, 2,4-D, and this happens? It could be something to where courts would look at it. No state has adopted it since Oklahoma. And I need to point out the one thing about when Oklahoma adopted this. The largest Supreme Court bribery scandal was going on at the time, but nobody knew it. So we actually don't know if the justices were taking bribes in this case or not. So there could be some reason why no state has followed this since. But it might be adopted as we look at 2,4-D and dicambas being used more and more often, and sensitive crops like grapes being grown next door to some people. The final idea is with negligence or with trespass, and for the most part, the majority of courts have said chemical sprays do not account for trespass. It has to be something bigger than a spray to be trespass. The main case is out of Minnesota, and in that case, it also involved organics. The sprayer sprayed, organic farmer got drift, organic farmer goes to certifier says you have to take it out of production for 3 years. The court actually said, A, there was no drift, and B, you didn't actually have to take the land out of production for 3 years because the state didn't tell you to do it. The certifier did it. So there's probably a problem with that case, as the certifier is kind of the state in most cases in most states. So there might be a problem there, but for the most part, the court did say trespass does not apply in these cases. So the remaining time, we're going to talk about violating regulations, i.e. not following the statute. And that's where, or the label, that's where most of these cases turn. If you're not following the label and drift happens, that's where they're pretty much willing to find liability. And I use this case to kind of highlight when you fall out of line with following the label, but it shows a good example too as well. Commercial applicator in Louisiana has been under investigation by the state numerous times. He does what anyone would do in this situation that's probably not thinking clearly, and decides he's going to spray the state official while they're photographing the aerial application from the road. Quick show of hands, how many people think a state official is on the label as an approved use? How many people think he's going to lose because that's what they're going to make this turn on? Yeah, the court agrees with the state that basically the state ag official is not an approved use on it. It's inconsistent, and they uphold the maximum fine. And for the most part, that's where these cases turn on. If you're not following the label, that's where they start imposing liability, and courts will rarely look at overturning that liability and those fines at that point. So negligence, for the most part, trespass are sometimes very hard to find in these cases. But this is much easier to show in looking at these. So kind of to wrap this up, and a review of the cases basically show it's going to turn on negligence. And the factors that courts have always looked at least for the most part, are how many witnesses saw it. For the most part, it's not going to be that many witnesses that see anything or see the drift cloud. It's probably, for the most part, always going to be a common pesticide. That's going to be hard to prove back to the person who actually sprayed it. And looking back, was the application made under safe conditions? Were the weather conditions perfect for it? Were all precautions taken? Were you in a temperature inversion? What type of conditions were taking place that day? Stricter liability may potentially apply in Maryland, but at this point, there's only one case, and it's out of Oklahoma, and we still don't know if anybody would follow it. They might, as we look at more 2,4-D and dicambas being used. And, you know, if you're under investigation by the state, don't spray the state ag official. And make sure you read the label clearly to follow what it says. It's the quickest way to find liability in these cases. I would like to say we put this publication together. It came out over the summer in regards to the dicamba issue, but it was in the pipeline before that, and we just kind of had it come out at the same time. But we do have a fact sheet out online, and you can find it up at that link right there, goumd.edu/pesticide drift. And are there any questions?
Any questions for Paul? Come on, we have an attorney here. You might
want to
ask him some questions.
Let's not play stump the chump.
If he's got time to answer a different question, can you explain the difference between a plant variety protection law and a genetic seed protection?
Can you repeat it?
Okay, can I explain the difference between the plant variety protected plant and a patent protected plant?
Right.
Okay, with Plant Variety Protection Act plants, you can replant them. So you can save the seed and replant them. You have that ability, but you're only allowed to replant basically the same amount that you harvested, so the same acreage that you harvested. So if you had 50 acres of plant variety protection plants, you can only save about enough to replant 50 acres. Patent protected, you can't save anything. You better just turn it back in and not try to replant it. That's the basic differences. There's a lot better protections with patent protected than plant variety protected. That's a lot of P's to have to say this early in the morning. Yeah, and we're working on trying to get some information out on that. We're supposed to have a meeting, I think, next week to kind of get some information out on what you can save and how you can save it. ahead of harvest time.
Yeah.
I think Bob Cradaville, and I forget who else are going to be in that.
So there was evidently there was a meeting. I was not involved with this meeting this week, but they were talking about patented seed and saving it for cover crop. So we're going to be working, Nate and I will be working, Ag Agent in Kent County will be working on that. Dale, would you like to come up and talk about that?
Yes, good morning. I'm Dale Morris with the Maryland Department of Agriculture, Turf and Seed. I'm the program manager there. Yes, we've had a lot of discussion about Plant Variety Protection Act and patented seed. And Paul is exactly right. Patented seed, there is no safe seed allowed, period. No exceptions, okay? Not even for cover crop. There's nothing on the label that says you can save it for cover crop seed. The Plant Variety Protection Act originally came into being in 70, then it was amended in 1994, allows for a farmer to save seed of a PV protected variety, okay, for his own holdings. No sale is allowed, no transfer, no exchange, anything like that, just for his own holdings. Okay, now, as you probably know, most soybeans, almost all soybeans are patent protected. Okay, now, that is changing. In the next few years, there is a couple state programs coming out with PVP protected soybeans. But at this point in time, you cannot save soybean seed. Getting to small grain seed, most wheat now, and I'm estimating at least 75% of the wheat seed that's sold is private label genetics that are patent protected. Okay, so basically 75%, at least 75% of the wheat seed being grown right now is patent protected and cannot be saved. There's about 25% of the wheat seed sold is PVP protected. So the farmer can save that for seed. There is no exemption for farmer safe seed except in the PVP varieties. You have to look at the label. The label will show whether it's patent protected or whether it's PVP protected, and they'll be very clear on that, okay? Now, as far as grain elevators, there is a case of patent exhaustion, which they've used for soybean, and that was the initial case that brought this to the Supreme Court in 2012 with Bowman, an Indiana farmer versus Monsanto. And the patent exhaustion does not hold true for soybeans or for small grain, basically. So if you're buying grain from an elevator and planting it back, it's illegal. It's illegal, pretty much. And from what I've been told, the penalty started $100 an acre up to $300 an acre.
Yeah.
It was pretty steep.
Yeah, they're pretty steep if you get caught. So, yes, we're meeting Thursday, and we've got a document hopefully coming out soon about safe seed, farmer safe seed, and liability. Okay?
It's always nice when the experts are, oh, Sonny, you had a question. Wait a minute, Dale, hold on.
The law says for planting purposes. It doesn't matter whether you're killing it or not. It's for planting purposes. Okay, now, what we're doing is we have a wheat line that we've released. It'll be called Louisa, coming out of the University of Maryland program. It's a bearded wheat, mid-season. It's a pretty decent yielder. We're releasing that specifically for the cover crop program. So it will be a PVP protected, but it will be allowed to be saved for seed. Okay, and we're trying to work with Virginia Tech to get another line. I'm working with an intellectual properties group down there and try to get another line out of Virginia Tech to be used in the cover crop program to be saved.
This is an update from MDA. They always give us the complaints that they've had during the year on pesticide drift. So they actually had 40 complaints. Of the 40 complaints, 12 were agriculture. 6 were from private applicators. 3 were from commercial aerial, and then 3 were from commercial ground. So in all, for what we do, not too bad, but I just wanted to give you that. So that's why I thought it was important for Paul to come and give us an update. So thanks, Paul.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, we'll hear from more of our sponsors. Let me see. I saw Greg Hahn. Would you like to say something?
Thank everybody for basically working with me and dealing with me. 2016 was kind of a rough year for me. I had some medical issues, and Mother Nature's not helping that out right now with the early spring. But, you know, basically, you know, just I think Mark had a very good presentation, and I know a lot of customers, they might not see Palmer amaranth, or they might think that they don't have a weed problem, but if your neighbor does, chances are you're probably going to have it. And pre-emergence herbicides, I just can't preach enough about them. So once again, I just wanted to thank you for your business, supporting me and Helena, and look forward to working with you all for 2017. Thank you.
Good morning again. I'm Emily Walbert. I'm a crop insurance agent with Farm Credit. Just a couple reminders, sales closing for spring crops is March 15th, so your agent should be working on getting you a quote if they haven't already. A couple different options that you can look at on your quote are the yield exclusion option. That looks at helping you exclude certain years from your 10-year database. Separate coverage levels by irrigated and non-irrigated. They do both have to be covered, but you can lower your irrigated and raise your non-irrigated. The enterprise unit structure can also help save you money. Just talk with your agent because you do have to make certain qualifications for that. And then the trend adjusted option, that looks at your 10-year database, but depending on your crop rotation, it can go back much farther than just those 10 years. So if you have any questions or you want to go over anything, we're here today, or I work in the Denton office where we have two other agents, and we also have one in Dover, two in Virginia, and one in Pennsylvania.
Good morning, everybody. Mark Saltonfuss is my name, from Nagel Crop Insurance. Greatly appreciate those of you who do business with us. Those of you who don't, we'd sure love to talk to you between now and March the 15th. One of the things I want you to be aware of on your crop insurance policy, the details on the front page are of primary importance. Make sure that the SBIs, anybody listed as part of your farming operation, make sure all that information is up to date and accurate. Marital status may have changed. Make sure that if you started a new entity, perhaps an LLC or an Inc., that is in line with your policy and the way that your grain is going to be sold. That's really important to make sure that those details are right. Lastly, we just really appreciate the community that we have here with Jenny, with the FSA offices. They work hand in hand with our line of business, and glad to see you all here. And if there's anything we can do for you, just don't hesitate to give us a call. Thank you.
I'm representing Centerville Plant Crop Production. Specifically Donegro Seed and Loveland Products. Appreciate your business last year and wish you a profitable 2017 season.
Good morning. My name is Mark Horst. I'm with Power Ag. Boy, it's good to see so many farmers in one place. You know what I love about you farmers is that you're always looking for a better crop than you had last year. Is that right? Either that or better pricing than you had last year. One of the two. Well, I can't help you with better pricing, but I can help you with better yields. You know, it wasn't that long ago we were satisfied with 100 bushel corn and 30, 40 bushel beans, and that was the status quo. What changed? Well, a lot changed. So what I'm telling you guys is don't be satisfied with just the status quo, all right? You know, we grew produce for about 20 years, my wife and I, and up in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and we would take tissue tests on a regular basis about every 2 weeks. We got labs like AgriLab that's here, represented here. Use them, right? Use them on your beans. Use them on your corn. Foliar feed your crops on a regular basis. That's important. If we want to, you guys are representing feeding the world, right? The farmland's getting less. The population's getting more. We got to do something different. We're going to have to increase our yields. We can't be satisfied with status quo, and that's where Power Ag comes in at. We have micronutrients. The company is based up in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. I'm the new face here on the shore. My wife and I moved down to Harmony about 2 years ago, so learning to know you guys and. So yeah, we have micronutrients. We have foliar feeds for your crops to foliar feed them and get a better yield. And that's what we're after. We gotta feed the world, right? So good luck with 2017. I wish you the very best. Thank you.